Good morning and welcome to Community Bible Church. Thank you for gathering together to worship the Lord with us here today. I need to mention a handful of announcements, so please, of course, refer to your bulletin, but I won't maybe mention all of them specifically, so be sure to read carefully what your bulletin has to say. First of all, we've mentioned this once already, but if you would like to donate towards Operation Christmas Child Shoebox shipping, you can designate that in the offering plate on an envelope, or you can see Wanda Knipp or Debbie Dillabaugh to make that donation. Also, we have a benefit sale coming up Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, May the 12th through the 14th. The best way for me to make this announcement is please refer to your bulletin for details. All right, so you can drop stuff off for the benefit sale on certain days, May the 4th through the 6th. You can help. There's a lot of different things and details there. So for that benefit sale, whether you're dropping stuff off or helping man the benefit sale or set up for the benefit sale, please see the details there in the bulletin. Also, let me remind us all that our facility is going to be used as a Jasper County voting center this week on Tuesday. The county staff will be coming in, county staff and volunteers will be coming in on Monday at about 2 or 3 in the afternoon. And so from that point on, none of us, even those of us who have a key, are not to go back to the gym. That includes the gym, the loft, and the kitchen, because let me tell you, folks, we don't want to be accused of any voting irregularities at Community Bible Church. So we're not supposed to be back there. If you're a Jasper County resident, you can vote here on Tuesday during regular voting hours, but you would need to go through the doors to the gym, not come through the hallway by the offices and Sunday school classes. Everything's above board, right? And that's also the reason the electronic sign is out in the parking lot. At some point, at least as far as I could tell, it wasn't flashing anything yet, no text on it yet, but they're going to have some information about vote here go up on that sign to let people know where they can vote on Tuesday. So I would also sort of say, if you have any questions about that, please let me know, because we want to make sure that we serve our community and the county staff and volunteers as well as we can. Also, just let me mention that part of our worship here at Community Bible Church is through giving. We give regularly. We give to the Lord's work. And through our church budget, we give towards the kingdom work of missionaries around the world and, of course, the maintenance of the ministries here at Community Bible Church. And so when we give to support things like Awana, and we just wrapped up Awana on Wednesday night, and it was just a great job by all of our staff and volunteers, or all of our volunteers for that. You just did a super job with the award ceremony and the fun fair. Thank you. It was really a fun time and a great end to our Awana season. Let's bow and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for really the privilege that it is to gather together as your people and to sing your praise, to depend upon you in prayer, to hear from you in your word. I pray, Lord, that you would draw us close to yourself. May Jesus be exalted, and may we worship him today. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's read the scriptures together from Psalm 103. Would you please stand with me? And we'll read verses 8 to 14. Read along out loud with me as I lead us. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. For he knows our frame, he He remembers that we are dust. Remain standing as the worship team comes and leads us to sing.
Well, good morning. It is so good to see all of you here this morning. Would you please join us in singing as we sing, "Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee."
Joyful, joyful, we adore Thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before Thee, hail Thee as the Son of love. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day.
All Thy works.
All Thy works with joy surround Thee. Earth and heaven reflect Thy rays. Stars and angels sing around Thee, center of unbroken grace. Field and forest, vale and mountain, flowery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in Thee. Thou art giving and forgiving, ever blessing, ever blessed, offspring of the joy of living, ocean, depths of happy rest. Thou the Father, Christ our brother, all who live in love are Thine. Teach us how to love each other, lift us to the joy divine. O mortals, join the
Amen. You may be seated.
This scripture reading is from Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Pray with me, please. What a reminder, as we sing to you and listen to the words of this passage, that All things ultimately are from you and through you and unto you, Father. We thank you that we're here because of the good work that you have begun in us, that we are your workmanship created in your Son, Christ Jesus, for good works, which you have prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. And we know that you are faithful to complete the good work that you've started in us. And that work, wow, according to this passage, includes your enablement in the person of your Spirit, in the person of your Son dwelling in us. Seems that we can hardly grow too much in our understanding of your love. Help us to know your grace and your goodness in your Son, Jesus Christ. Pray that for each person here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand together as we continue to sing.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt, yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled.
Peace.
So we are going to sing a new song. We're going to teach a new song to you. It's called Yet Not I, But Through Christ in Me. And one of the incredible graces that we receive from salvation is being united in Christ. The ability to walk the Christian life is a big piece of what this talks about. It's not our own doing. It's through Christ in us. So we're going to play through the first verse and kind of sing so you can get a feel for how it goes, and then we're going to go back and do the first verse again, and we'll sing through the whole song. What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
All right, let's sing that again. What gift of grace?
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace.
To this I hold.
I hope, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to Him. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. It's dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold.
With every breath,
I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hope, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is
Well, boys and girls, second grade and down, you can be dismissed to go to your class. Do we have any second grade and down today? Maybe not. Okay, they're already back there. Good deal. Let's pray together. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you and we are thankful, of course, oh God, that our growth in Christ, our salvation, our hope for heaven is not grounded upon ourselves, but it is in Christ and in him alone. And so, Lord, we are thankful for it. We ask, O Lord, that you would strengthen us to hear your word here this morning, that we would be responsive with faith and obedience. And Lord, I pray that you would encourage us today, that we would be drawn near to you, and that we would see, sort of, as it were, the power grid of the grace of God flowing to us in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that, Lord, we would ask for that grace, that we would depend upon that grace, and that we would live, that we live by it. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. So if you really think about it, the idea of forgiveness is a little bit scandalous, right? For someone to commit a crime, or maybe sometimes we don't think of all of our sins as a crime, but they are crimes against God. For someone to commit a crime and then to be forgiven, sort of carte blanche of that crime, that is scandalous. So just do a little thought experiment with me. What if Hitler had survived the war, had trusted in Christ for the forgiveness of his sins, and asked to be a member of Community Bible Church? That would make the newspaper, right? That would be all over the interwebs, right? If he was a member of our church, or had been, or whatever. That would be a scandal. And once in a while, such things happen. If I remember correctly, Manuel Noriega, which I think you have to be my age or older to remember his crimes, but nevertheless, he was imprisoned, and if I remember correctly, led to the Lord by another prisoner or a prison chaplain and baptized as a believer. So these... when we talk about grace, We have to keep in mind that sometimes God's grace is kind of a scandal. And to some degree, that's part of what Paul the Apostle is dealing with in Romans chapter 5, beginning in verse number 20, down through chapter 6, verse number 5. So I want to ask you to turn in your Bibles to that passage, Romans chapter 5, beginning in verse number 20. And if you're going to follow along in the outline in the bulletin, just number one is kind of what I've already been talking about. Salvation by grace is a dangerous doctrine. Salvation by grace is a dangerous doctrine. And we're going to see how Paul the Apostle responds to that in chapter 5, Romans chapter 5, verses 20 down through verse 6, verse number 5. So here we go. Now the law came in to increase the trespass. So we've talked about this before, and the idea is simply this, that the Ten Commandments and the other surrounding laws of God, the moral law of God, things which call us to love God and worship Him with all of our heart, mind, and soul, and things which call us to love our neighbor as ourselves and to treat our fellow man as we would like to be treated, those laws, that kind of divine and social contract, those things really were presented in the Old Testament to convince the Israelites that they really were sinners, right? They could look around if they wanted to, and they could see Egyptians and Canaanites who were very sinful, right? Idolatrous rebels against God. And they needed to be reminded that on the inside they weren't any different, right? So that's what the law was there for. So the law came in to increase the trespass or to highlight the knowledge of sin, the personal knowledge of personal sin. But where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. Where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. So just a personal aspect of that sort of theology. What I started with was, if Hitler had survived the war, had asked God for forgiveness for his sins, right, and asked to become, trusted in Christ, become a Christian, and asked to become a member of our church, some of you, just the very thought of that made your blood pressure rise, right? But if we do not believe that God can forgive any and all sins, then we're all in trouble because we're worse than somebody, right? And so what we said as I was preaching through Romans chapter 5 a few weeks ago was that the end of verse number 20 means this, a quotation from a Puritan author. It means that there is more grace in Jesus than there is sin in me. And if that's true, then there is more grace in Jesus than there is sin in anybody. And then he goes on in verse number 21 to kind of expand on some of those things and kind of wrap up everything he's been saying in chapter 5. But for our purposes today, let's skip to chapter 6, verse number 1. So if grace abounds all the more when sin increased, then there is a potential objection to that. There is also a potential misinterpretation of that, and he deals with that in chapter 6, beginning in verse number 1. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? Right? In other words, if God's grace is exalted, if God's grace is elevated, when sin abounds, when, as it were, Paul might apply to himself, when the chief of sinners is saved from their sins and forgiven, if grace is exalted, if God's character is exalted because of that, then should we not just wholesale live in sin? And of course, his answer in verse number 2 is, by no means, by no means. If you have the King James Version, a lot of times people think of the King James Version as being the most strict and the most, perhaps, technically accurate. Well, they, to express the strength of this Greek phrase, they actually don't translate, they paraphrase, and they say, God forbid. The noun God is not there. It's just their way of saying, in the most strong way as possible, this is the strongest possible Greek negative. By no means. Absolutely not, he says. Positively, highlighted, exclamation point, all of those things. No, absolutely not. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him. By the way, he uses the idea of burial there to just remind us that it's like what we say, dead and buried, right? Dead and gone, really dead, okay? Genuinely, it's the final period at the end, the death, the funeral, the dinner, and the burial, right? Jesus was really dead. We know that because he was buried. And our life before Christ is dead. It's really dead. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. So, once again, number one, salvation by grace is a dangerous doctrine. Remember what I've already said. Chapter 5, verse number 20, we've said that that means there's more grace in Jesus than there is sin in me. If it's true for me, it's true for you. If it's true for all of us, it's true for everybody. Right? And he's dealing with this potential misinterpretation of the doctrine of justification by grace through faith. There is this sort of stream of shallow logic that might say something like this. This is a handy passage of Scripture. This is a handy doctrine. I like the first few chapters of the book of Romans, because if God has provided a way for my salvation, and it's not me working really hard not to sin, and if it's not me working really hard to make up for it when I do sin, if God has provided this as a gift of grace, then that's handy. I can just move on with life and not even consider when I sin, when I don't sin, how bad it is, who it hurts, or anything like that. Let's move on and just sin with abandon. If God's grace is greater, even when there is lots of sin, fine with me, right? Paul does not beat around the bush when he deals with this. He gets right down to business and he smacks down this logic with verse number 2. By no means, absolutely not, may it never be, period. Full stop, exclamation point. And so, number two, he bases this prohibition to sin with abandon, carelessly, he bases that on, number two, the believer's union with Christ. The believer's union with Christ. So, when Paul the Apostle in verse number 2 talks about we who died to sin, when he talks about that, he's referring kind of to a couple of different things. First of all, he is referring backwards to chapter 5 where he set up this kind of representational system where he claims that all sinned in Adam, in chapter 5, verse number 12, everyone sinned, everyone is guilty because Adam sinned. Remember, I kind of explained that as when God thought of us, even before we existed, he thought of us as sinners because Adam, our representational head, had sinned. And also, he set this up in chapter 5, verse number 19, so that all those who believe are made righteous in Christ because our Lord Jesus Christ and those who trust in him and are connected to him and are forgiven because of him, our sins are washed away because Christ died for them, right? And because we are in Christ Jesus our Lord. He's also pointing to this union with Christ, that we are vitally, spiritually united to him. I'm going to explain a little bit more about that in a second. But nevertheless, what Paul is simply saying is that our union with Christ, our unity to him, is like a guardrail against this false logic that because of God's grace we can sin with abandon. right? So let me explain it this way. I'm going to use marriage as kind of an illustration a couple of times later. But whenever a man or a woman says yes, when they say I do at the altar, they are saying I don't to every other woman in the world, right? When you say I do to Jesus, you are united to him in a union stronger than the bonds of marriage, and that is a calling, a compelling calling to say no to sin. Okay, so he's basically, and that's the logic that he's using here. How can we be united? And he's saying that we died with him, and he's appealing to this logic of we've been united to him, and his death is our death as well. It is, God looks at us as if we died on that same cross for our sins, because we died with Christ. And it is a guardrail against this shallow logic that promotes sin by as if it is elevating God's grace. Now, let me ask this question. What is our union with Christ? What is that? What is this union with Christ? I've already mentioned how it is comparable to our being united to Adam in Adam's sin. So also, when God thinks of us, he sees Christ's purity. He sees Christ's righteousness. He sees Christ's goodness. It is the spiritual uniting of our lives with Christ's. Our destiny has changed. We have moved from death to life. I have to admit, this is hard to understand, okay? This is something more or less that I can illustrate, but to really get it, you need to experience it, period. You need to experience the reality, and in this context, where it gives this connection to Christ, gives you the power and grace to live for God and say no to all of the other potential brides, right? To say no to sin. And so let me give a couple of illustrations. And these, the Bible does this, by the way. In John chapter 15, Jesus uses the illustration of the vine and the branches, right? Where I am the vine, Jesus says, and you are the branches. And basically, we can do nothing without him. There is this connection. And it's not just an outward connection. It's just not that the branch is duct taped on, right? It's a living connection. And the branch receives its very sustenance from the vine. And so do we. We receive the sustenance from Jesus himself. Earlier this week, I was reading Mark chapter 6. And Mark chapter 6 is, sometimes I refer to it or I think of it as the busyness chapter, right? And because of the busyness of ministry, the disciples did not have time to eat even. And so Jesus says, come away with me to a quiet place and rest. And as you know, before the beginning of this week, I had been in a very busy time in my life, right? You know, there was dad's passing and funeral and a pastor's conference and all of these things. And so I felt, as it were, the vital sap of Christ's goodness flow to my heart through that passage of Scripture. Right, I felt connected. I experienced this. It was, yes, a feeling. It was an experience. It was real. I felt the life of Christ be meaningful to me. As it were, he invited me to come away to a quiet place and rest. And to reflect and to pray and to be with the Lord Jesus Christ. So I can illustrate it. Jesus illustrated it. There's the dependence of the branch upon the vine. There is the sustenance from the vine to the branch. But you need to experience that for yourself. Paul illustrated it with marriage in Ephesians chapter 5. He uses the phrase of they shall become one flesh, quoting from Genesis, right? So the one flesh union in marriage does give birth to new life, does it not? And also we might think of the bride. We are compared to the bride as the bride of Christ, our bridegroom, and a bride takes her husband's name, at least in traditional Western societies, right? I know that some of those things are changing now. This is not a comment about that, but traditionally, Brides take their husband's name. We are identified with Christ. And in many marriages, the bride has a right to the groom's money, right? And we can cash in our spiritual checks because Jesus has signed them. He's made the promise. He has paid the price. And ultimately, where we're going to get to in chapter 6 is the bondage of sin has been broken. And it's because Jesus broke it for us. Our husband, our bridegroom, broke it for us. And also in Ephesians chapter 5, Paul admits that this is a mystery, right? That there are some things that are difficult about this to understand and simply need to be experienced. I'm going to share another illustration of this union with Christ a little bit later in the sermon. Number three. I want to talk about the crucial significance of baptism. Verses 3 and 4, the only places in the book of Romans where baptism is even mentioned. These verses have been debated about what kind of baptism is Paul talking about here, what is the significance of baptism and all. I'm just going to kind of give you the results of what I have come to believe about these verses without going into all of the details of all the other possible interpretations, okay? So let me just carefully read verses 3 and 4 again. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried with him by baptism into death in order that, by the way, that's really important, in order that, so whatever we think about baptism up above this point, all of it was in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Now, these verses can be confusing because of the way that Paul uses baptism and his meaning for it. Let me just say a couple of very, very clear things. Paul the Apostle is not saying that we are saved by baptism from our sins. Okay, he is not saying that. Paul the Apostle, I don't know if you figured this out or not, but Paul the Apostle is a very, very careful, clear, and logical thinker. He would not give three chapters on why we are saved by grace through faith and then come here and say, oh, forget all of that, we're now saved by baptism. Okay, he would never do that. The Holy Spirit obviously would not contradict himself, and certainly Paul would not either. Right? So he is not saying that we are saved by baptism. That's not what he's talking about. He is also not saying that baptism is the means of salvation. He is using baptism, as it were, as a label for everything that happens to a person surrounding their salvation. They are saved from their sins. They are converted from being dead to being alive. When we believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ, we experience salvation, and he is using baptism as a symbolic, literal, like physical, illustration of a person literally and spiritually being united to Christ by faith. So let me use another illustration that will help you get this. Both communion, which we will receive this morning, and baptism illustrate the same thing. They illustrate our union to Christ. Okay? So when we receive communion, we actually eat the cracker and we drink the juice. And it becomes a part of our caloric intake and literally becomes a part of our cellular structure. It is incorporated into our body. That is an illustration of Christ in us, right? That Christ is so closely, vitally, spiritually united to us that it can be said that he is in us. Christ in you, the hope of glory, is a phrase that Paul the Apostle uses. Right? And so Christ dwells within our hearts richly through the Holy Spirit. He is with us, in us, literally. And sometimes we see that, we experience that, especially when we know his presence is with us during trauma, difficulty, darkness, depression, and when God works through us, when Christ works through us to help others, encourage others, strengthen others. We can experience Christ in us in those kinds of ways, and I'm sure others as well. Baptism is an illustration of us being incorporated into Christ. It is as if we are submerged into Him. And what is defining of our status is Christ and His glory, His goodness, His righteousness, His holiness, His purity, His obedience. And what is defining about us in God's eyes is not our sinfulness and falling short and our emptiness. What is defining, we have been submerged into Him. So communion and baptism illustrate two parts of the same union with Christ Jesus, Christ in us for communion and us in Christ for our baptism. Now, I do want to just make a quick point, because this is the only place in Romans that baptism is mentioned. And Paul the Apostle is building this kind of logical argument on something about baptism. So we have to just pause for a moment and say baptism is important. It is important. It's important, and this is in your notes, and so you can kind of follow along. I'm going to go through these quickly. Baptism is important because Jesus commanded it. He told His disciples to make disciples and to baptize them and to teach them. Jesus commanded it in Matthew chapter 28. Baptism is important because it is a public declaration of personal faith. In the book of Acts, people believed and were baptized. They believed the truth of the gospel, and they said so through a specific act by following the Lord Jesus Christ's command to be baptized. So, baptism is important because Christ commanded it. It's important because it is our personal a public declaration of our personal faith. Also, it represents our unity with the church or with the community of believers. So in Ephesians chapter 4, Paul the Apostle refers to all of these different things that unite us. And so there is one faith and one baptism and one Father and God of all. It's one Spirit. And so, among other things, baptism is the most sort of public and physical direct declaration of our unity with the Christian church. Baptism is important because it represents our personal commitment to follow Christ. So if we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, Jesus commanded His disciples to baptize disciples. And that is your declaration that I intend to follow Jesus Christ. I belong to Him. I am His and He is mine. And of course, as I've been saying, baptism is important because it represents, it is a physical representation in obedience to Christ's command to represent our union with Christ. So, baptism is important. It is seriously important. It symbolizes our salvation, but it is not our salvation. It is not our salvation. It is not the means of our salvation. It is the representation of our salvation. It is still symbolic. John Stott said this, "Baptism does not by itself secure what it signifies." So, let me just make a couple of applications and then we'll move on. If you are a Christian, you should be baptized. If you consider yourself a Christian, you should be baptized. Now, I understand that sometimes parents encourage their children to put it off a little bit so that there is a greater assurance of salvation and greater evidence of salvation. I do understand that. But at some point, as a child matures, they need to be baptized if they continue in the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. Being a genuine believer in the Lord Jesus Christ and not being baptized would be like standing at the altar and saying, "No, I don't think I'll put that ring on. Let me just put that in my pocket." It is our way of wearing the wedding ring that Christ offers to His people. By the way, I'm just going to say these things, okay? There is no direct scriptural evidence that somehow baptism symbolizes an entrance into the covenant of grace or into the community of faith. So that's the reason we do not practice infant baptism here. If you want baptism to symbolize what it symbolizes in the Bible, then we should be baptized after our conversion to the Lord Jesus Christ. So, if you're a Christian, you should be baptized. Now, number four, our spiritual union with Christ provides a new way of life. It provides a new way of life. That's why I pointed out in verse number four, we were buried with him, therefore, by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Paul the Apostle is saying that something has happened to believers spiritually so that we can experience a new way of life practically every day. So there are just a couple of passages of Scripture that are worth looking up that help us see this maybe from a slightly different angle. So look up Galatians chapter 2. Some of you have memorized this. I'm sure our Awana kids have memorized this. Galatians chapter 2, verse number 20. Again, Romans 6:4, Galatians 2:20 are saying something has happened to believers spiritually so that we can experience a new way of life practically. Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ. There it is, the same exact kind of logical thought and vocabulary. I have been crucified with Christ. This is in the form of a testimony from Paul himself. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Again, being united with Christ, him in me and me in him. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I mean, you have so much packed into that one verse. You have the atonement. He gave himself for me personally, for individuals. You have this being united with him, being crucified and raised with the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, the power of sin has been broken, not erased, but it has been broken. And the power to live for God has been, as it were, connected. It's been connected. So I double-checked this with our resident linesman, who actually is being a linesman right now and can't be at church because he's on call. But Greg told me this morning that there's and he told me this is kind of a new technology. I think I experienced it before I understood it. But sometimes your power will go off, and sometimes it'll come back on in a second or two. But then sometimes it'll go off for a minute or more, and then what happens is the power grid is set up with some kind of technology so that if the power grid can do this, he said it kind of talks to itself. It's a little bit of mystery in that too, but there's apparently some computers involved. And it will reroute, I would think of it as almost backfeeding it from a different direction, from a different pole to your house, right? And it'll come back on. And so it's not, so there's been a compromise somewhere down here, and your house is here, so the power's coming this direction now. That's my layman's term. I'm sure Greg could do a better job of explaining it, but we still might not understand it. And that's what's happened. The power of sin has been broken over here, and we have been given a fresh new power to live the way in the light of Christ, the way that we were meant to live to begin with. This is astounding, right? This is, think of it this way. This new way of living is different from the old way. This new way of living is comprehensive. God intends for this new way of living by the grace of God and the power of Christ to permeate every avenue of our hearts and of our lives. This new way of living is like a good faith deposit on new creation. Remember when Paul the Apostle said, old things are passed away. Behold, everything is made new. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5. That passage is actually looking forward to when not only will we be made new, the whole heavens and earth will be made new. Our lives are like a dim reflection of what the new heavens and the new earth will be like. This new way of living is empowered by the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. Did you see that in chapter 6, Romans 6, verse number 4? Just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, Jesus was raised from the dead because the Father, in his power, kept his promise to raise him from the dead because of his character and his glory. And so we also are by that same power, the power of God that gave Jesus' body physical life again, is working in us to transform us in this new way of living. This is like atomic power. This is astounding power of God raising us to new life. It's not just turning over a new leaf, right? Human effort can make certain changes. You can quit certain things and start other things just by the power of human effort and habit. But this is talking about inner transformation. This is literal new life itself. Jesus, in John chapter 3, calls this being born again. So, let me just kind of review and then wrap up. Back to Paul's original concern, does the doctrine of salvation by grace through faith make people careless about sin? As I've said so many times, absolutely, positively, no. It does not. In fact, only grace can actually transform the whole person and give us a whole new way of living. I'm going to make a quick confession and then wrap up. I realize that the application for this sermon comes later, okay? It comes in the next few verses. It comes especially in Romans 6, 11 through 14. So we will get there. Part of the application this morning is simply this. As you reflect on communion, remember that this represents Christ in us. That we are mysteriously, spiritually, powerfully, incredibly united to Him. Remember that. Part of the application is simply believe these things, meditate on these things, and let them impact your heart and your life, really, as we prepare for what Paul's going to say next as we move on in the passage. And then let me say this. Our hymns, so many of our hymns, especially ones that we've come to love in the last 15 or so years, talk about this so boldly and so beautifully. So we actually sang it this morning, part of verse number 1, of yet not I, but Christ in me. The end of verse number 1 says this, oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine. Right? All spiritual blessings are mine. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. And then from In Christ Alone, this is verse number 3, listen to this. There in the ground his body lay. I want you to see how these hymns poetically capture the connection between Jesus' death, burial, resurrection, and our new Christian life, our Christian living. Thus the title of the sermon, Christian Living and the Resurrection of Christ. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the graves he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For, here it is, union with Christ, I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. This is he will hold me fast. For my life he bled and died, crucifixion, Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied, atonement, he will hold me fast. Raised with him to endless life, raised with Christ Jesus, he will hold me fast. And then future, till our faith is turned to sight when he comes at last. And then this is come behold the wondrous mystery. Come behold, what is it? A wondrous mystery, right? I mean this, don't expect that you will get this all figured out, this being united with Christ Jesus in his death and resurrection. This you can spend the rest of your life, you can spend all of eternity experiencing and knowing these things. Behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death, the God of life, but no grave could e'er restrain him. Praise the Lord, he is alive. What a foretaste of deliverance, our deliverance. And we taste it now, we will fully experience it in the future. How unwavering our hope now, Christ in power resurrected, as we will be when he comes. Let's pray. Lord, we are grateful for these truths. These are not simple. They are radical, even scandalous. And yet we are grateful for them. We ask, O God, that you would help us to digest them spiritually and depend upon them in our practical Christian living day by day by day. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as we prepare to receive communion, as I mentioned in an email earlier this week, we are going to receive communion by passing the trays. If you would prefer not to receive the tray, you kind of hold up your hand and they'll just pass your row by, and you can get one of the little kits at the sound table if that's what you would like. But let me just remind us that, just like I've been saying, communion is a way of saying to ourselves, I am his and he is mine. And reminding ourselves, we belong to Jesus in something that is stronger than the bonds of human marriage, because it is the divine linking of our very spiritual life with the life of Jesus Christ himself. And we remind ourselves of this because we need to be. This, as I have said, this is a mystery we'll never plumb the depths of. And so we just keep by faith believing it and living upon its power. If you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ here today, you're welcome to receive communion with us. But receive it thoughtfully, receive it prayerfully, and remember and reflect on his saving death for us. I want to invite our men that are prepared to help serve. We're going to sing. My apologies. Let's stand and sing together. And what are we singing? There is a fountain.
Let's sing together.
There is a fountain.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners' blood beneath that flood proves all their guilty stains.
Their guilty
sins by faith. I saw the stream, thy flowing wounds supply. Redeeming love has been my theme, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die. Redeeming love has been my theme, and shall be till I die.
When this poor lisping, stammering tongue,
in this poor lisping, stammering tongue, thy silent in the grave, then in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing your power to save. I'll sing your power to save. I'll sing your power to save. Then in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing your power to save.
Amen. You may be seated.
And as our worship team comes to be seated, I want to invite our men to come, who are prepared to lead us in receiving communion. We are going to, as I mentioned in our communication, we're going to sort of have a double stacked cup, so you'll have a cracker underneath the juice. You'll need to take them, pass the tray on, and then separate them to be prepared to receive the bread first. Christ was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he passed it around to his disciples and he said to them, "This is my body broken for you." O Lord Jesus Christ, we are grateful that you were crushed for our transgressions. As we read this morning, that you were given for us to save us from our sins. We thank you that you, the Creator, the Master, the Lord of all, allowed your flesh to be beaten, bruised, broken, pierced. That you bore the wrath of your Holy Father, who loved you and whom you loved, and you paid the price for our sins. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Jesus also took a cup and, of course, again passed it around to his disciples. And he also said to them, "This is my blood, which is given for you. Drink from it, all of you." Oh, Heavenly Father, we are thankful that you have planned from eternity past for the sacrifice of your Son for our sins. Thank you that you carried this plan through, brought it to fruitfulness over the many centuries and millennia, preparing the way for your Son to come and then to die for our sins. Thank you that you cared enough, that you loved us enough to plan, to prepare, and to pay for our salvation in your Son's blood. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Thank you, men. As you're leaving today, there's a couple of offering plates that have benevolence offering marked on them. If you would like to give towards the Benevolence Fund to help people both in our church and in our community who are in financial need, you can do that. Our deacons do an excellent job, deacons and elders, do an excellent job of kind of supervising that fund. If there's anything on your heart that you would like to talk or pray with me about, I certainly would be happy to stick around afterwards, say something to me as you leave in the line, and I'll make a time either this afternoon right away or through the week to spend time with you talking and praying. Go in the grace of the Lord. You're dismissed.